Sonia Brown needs no introduction.
Thank you, my brother. Thank you. Good morning, friends.
Good morning, my friends.
I feel very blessed to be here this morning to share with you and to share with my wonderful friend, Freddie. I couldn't be more blessed. This morning, I thought I would share some thoughts with you about purity of heart. I believe that most of us will recall that Jesus the Master, in what is commonly referred to as the Sermon on the Mount, shared some ideas for living called the beatitudes. The sixth of these is, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. It is interesting that the word beatitude is a combination of two words, be and attitude. And the beatitudes tell you what attitude you should be in. Two of the definitions of the word be that I came across are to constitute the same class as, to have identity with. And the meaning of pure, totally unadulterated, not mixed or adulterated with any other substance or material. Definition of heart, the central or innermost part of something, the vital center and source of one's being, emotions, and sensibilities, the repository of one's deepest and sincerest feelings and beliefs. And the meaning of blessed, highly favored. Therefore, I would say that the beatitude is saying, highly favored is he who is unadulterated in his innermost part, in his vital center, for he shall see God. What does it mean to see God? Emma Curtis Hopkins, who was called the teacher of teachers, quoting from the Upanishads in her book, High Mysticism, says, thou canst not behold me, big me, big M, with thy two outer eyes. I have given thee an eye divine. And further on, she says, the divine eye or vision is the sense with which we perceive truth or reality. To see God then is to see with the divine eye. And it's a feeling, it's more a feeling and a knowing and an embracing. It's to have spiritual discernment, to know and to know that you know. What is truth or reality? Quoting from the science of my textbook, truth is that which is. It is the reason, cause, and power in and through everything. It is birthless, deathless, changeless, complete, perfect, whole, self-existent, causeless, Almighty, God, Spirit, Law, Mind, Intelligence, and anything and everything that implies reality. And reality, the truth about anything. Reality actually means that it is indestructible, incapable of decay. Reality is unchanging and everlasting. Now, what is indestructible, incapable of decay, unchanging and everlasting? I believe this is the God presence within and around us. It just is. To see with the eye divine then is to experience His holy presence. It is the experience of embodied our Christhood. At this stage, we are one with the One. I believe that this is what the sixth beatitude speaks of. Having a conscious awareness of oneness with our Source and how to achieve it. In a nutshell, to fully embody our oneness with the One, we must be pure in heart. The following quotation has been attributed to our pastor, Henry Boone. I am sharing it with you because I believe it so aptly describes what I would like to convey about the need for purity. Here goes. According to the nature and character of the fountain, will be the character of the stream. The heart may be compared to a reservoir which supplies a large town with its hundreds of streets and thousands of pipes. If the water be pure in the reservoir, it will be conveyed in its purity through the pipes to the inhabitants. But if turbid there, it will be impure at its destination. The heart is the reservoir from which life flows. The mouth, hands, feet, loins, actions, etc. are the pipes. If the heart is pure, purity will be manifested in life. End of quotation. Purity in heart. No matter our level of education and our qualifications, this is not what allows us to know and reveal our Christhood. This is not learned from any person. The true teacher is within. When we are pure in heart, we hear the true teacher, the Christ within. To be truly at one with our Source, our true teacher, we have to be unadulterated in mind and spirit, free from outside noises, outside opinions, outside dictates, biases, and prejudices. Only the dictates of the free spirit within, unconditioned, pure, free. All the formal education, all the prescribed modes of behavior, cannot supersede the wonder of the mind of Christ, that mind that was in the Master Jesus and is in each of us now. As Mrs. Hopkins puts it, all the learnedness of the world cannot compass the wonder of the mind of Christ, who knew all things and needed not that any man should teach him. She goes on, who is ready by acknowledgement to wash sometimes in the pool of silence or complete negation of himself in heavenly abandon to the great scripturally proclaimed neutral to the sin of the world, living like Paul, only as Christ liveth in me. End of quote. Here, Mrs. Hopkins is equating washing in the pool of Siloam with getting rid of the ego, complete negation of himself, that is the human ego. She's in fact saying that the person who does this gives himself in complete abandonment to God, this great scripturally totally neutral, and allows, like St. Paul, the Christ, the true Son of God, to live through him. The silence to which Mrs. Hopkins referred to here is the pool of silence spoken of in the Gospel according to John chapter 9, verses 1 to 12. Those of us who grew up in the traditional churches will remember the story of the blind man who was instructed by the Master Jesus to go wash in the pool of Siloam. We are told that the man who had been blind from birth was taken to Jesus to be healed of his blindness. The story goes that Jesus spat on the ground and made clay with the spittle, then anointed the man's eyes with the clay. Jesus then told him to go and wash in the pool of Siloam. The man did as Jesus instructed and came back seeing. In the Gospel according to John, we are told that when the people saw that he was able to see, they said, "How then were thine eyes opened?" He answered, "The man that is called Jesus made clay and anointed my eyes and said unto me, 'Go to Siloam and wash.' So I went away and washed, and I received sight." At the beginning of the story, we are told that Jesus' disciples asked him whether it was the man or his parents who had sinned, why the man had been born blind. And Jesus responded that neither did this man sin nor his parents, but that the works of God should be made manifest in him. Here were the disciples giving in to raised belief. That is, that the man's mind blindness must be attributable to the sins of the fathers or sins of the man himself. How often are we tempted to limit ourselves through conditioning by raised belief, rather than allowing Spirit to flow unimpeded through us? However, here we see that the man obeyed his instructions to wash in the pool of Siloam, and as a result received sight. I believe that we too should follow the instruction of Spirit, the inner promptings, and allow our light to shine through. The Metaphysical Bible Dictionary says that to go wash in the pool of Siloam means to deny false ideas, to deny the universal race belief in the reality and power of matter, and to affirm the spirituality of all substance. You will recall that the blind man went away from the crowd to wash in the pool of Siloam. I would like to suggest that this going away should be applied to our own lives and affairs. Go away from the noises. Go away from the media. Go away from the constant chatter. Go to that place of quiet rest where Spirit flows unimpeded through us and speaks to us. Go within. I believe that the mud on the outer eyes of the man made them impenetrable to light. He was unable to see clearly because his outer eyes were focusing on the appearance, not on the true reality. I think most of us are guilty of the same. Instead of focusing on the true light, the light divine, we allow our view to become marred by the appearances and the chatter around us, cluttering up our thought processes and hampering the free flow of divine light through us in all situations. We hamper true understanding when we do this by giving power to material things and conditions, which then impede our spiritual unfoldment. The washing away of the mud by the man himself shows that we ourselves, by our own choice, can refrain from giving power to the appearances and use our eye divine, giving power to that which is eternal and free. How do we go from where we might be to be in company with your heart? The starting point is in the laboratory of our minds. We have to clear out the clutter. The founder of this church teaching, Dr. Ernest Holmes, tells us, our mental attitudes are our most priceless possessions. No material security is actually secure, but the deep issues of our thought can make or unmake us. To look out upon our world and expect only good from it is true spiritual living. Then security is assured, for our own right mental attitudes will produce it. The intelligence which created us requires our cooperation with the laws of right thinking based on right motives. End of quote. I came across a website which addresses sterile conditions which have to be maintained to ensure that tissue culture does not become contaminated. I believe that some of the conditions which must be maintained to keep tissue culture pure can be applied to the laboratory of our minds. The following words from the article jumped out at me. Contamination most frequently occurs through avoidable procedural errors. Practicing good aseptic techniques is critical to maintaining the purity of cell cultures as well as a safe lab environment. I thought it would be interesting to compare the preventative measures employed to avoid contamination in a microbiology lab with the preventative measures we should employ to ensure that the laboratory of our minds are uncontaminated. The article states that modern laboratories are busy environments with personal sharing of equipment across overlapping workstations that may be near high traffic areas. I couldn't help laughing as in my mind's eye, I saw workers in a business, in a corporation, in an office, speaking across workstations, sharing the latest news and offering opinions. We tend to share opinions with one another and discuss situations without regard to what we are taking into the laboratory of our minds. The article goes on. Attention should be paid to lab design. Every lab should have a dedicated area for cell culture that is separate from high traffic area. A dedicated area for cell culture. In applying this to the laboratory of our own minds, I would say that our dedicated area should be that inner place to which we should go daily for guidance. This inner place is the closet which Jesus spoke of when he told us to go into our closet and pray. We withdraw into our closet from the high traffic area, the outer world of materialism, limitation, fear, doubt, misgivings, sensationalism. Go ye apart from this high traffic area to that dedicated area within. Culturing procedure. Practicing good aseptic technique will help advance research. The first step in an aseptic culturing procedure is to avoid cross-contamination by only working with one cell line at a time. Borrowing from this, we avoid cross-contamination by keeping the eye single. Mrs. Hopkins tells us that all the forces of the universe cooperate with vision towards the beatific ideals. Good aseptic technique in our laboratories with advanced spiritual unfoldment. What are some of these aseptic techniques? For words of truth, refrain from negative conversations. Be open and receptive to guidance from within. Pray without ceasing. In all things, seek the advice of the source. Cleaning procedures. To maintain sterile work surfaces, a standard operating procedure for properly maintaining, cleaning, and disinfecting equipment, work surfaces and non-work surfaces need to be implemented. To maintain our purity of heart, we should be committed and consistent with our surgical practices. We should live well, regular meditation and prayer. These keep the laboratory of our minds aseptic from the influence of race consciousness. Joel Goldsmith in Practicing the Presence tells us, continuous inner meditation, continuous reaching toward the center of our being will eventually result in the experience of the Christ. In truth, we were all created pure because we all come from the eternal, absolute, and unconditioned source, which we call God. However, over the period of our lives, we have become conditioned in various ways that have, in a sense, hidden our true nature. This is why Jesus, the Master Teacher, said that we should become as little children in order to enter the kingdom of heaven. Tools which are taught here at the temple to assist us in keeping our hearts pure and to awaken to our spiritual magnificence include meditation, affirmation, and spiritual mind treatment or affirmative prayer. Regular daily meditation helps to quiet the mind, moves attention from restless thoughts, and clarifies awareness. It helps to sharpen our intuitive faculties. Regular practice of meditation allows us to develop the ability to be still. It assists us to open ourselves to a state of receptivity to our infinite potential. Affirmations are positive statements of truth, which, with repetition, leads the mind to that state of consciousness where it accepts the truth which is being affirmed. Spiritual mind treatment, or affirmative prayer, is a form of prayer which is taught and used here. It may be taught as a three-step, five-step, or seven-step process. In the five-step process, the steps are recognition, unification, realization, thanksgiving, and release. The purpose of this form of prayer is to bring us to a consciousness of our oneness with God. Simply put, in recognition, we recognize the qualities of God. In unification, we affirm our oneness with these qualities. In realization, we affirm that these qualities are already there, ready to be revealed. We give thanks and we release all to God, to the universe, knowing it is already done. I would just like to share a story with you which highlights the benefits of meditation. A past issue of the Science of Mind magazine carried an article called Listening to Your Inner Voice by Douglas Block, an author, counselor, and teacher who writes on the subjects of psychology, healing, and spirituality. In the article, Mr. Block says that his first experience of hearing the inner voice occurred in December 1987 while he was attending a Christmas Eve service. He says that in the midst of meditation, he received a strong message to begin work on a book on spiritual healing, in which he would share with others much of what he had learned on his own journey over the past two decades. He said that the guidance did not make sense, as he was already working on another book that was going quite well. But, and here I quote, as I came to learn, the voice of intuition does not have to make sense, for it comes from a much higher plane than that of reason and logic. End of quote. And so, on Christmas Day, 1987, he began work on a book, Words That Heal. He says that during the next 8 months, his inner voice continued to guide him every step of the way. Whether it was a designer, editor, or printer that he needed, he seemed to draw to him all the people required for the project. No matter what the situation, he was supported by invisible hands. Mr. Block says, the divine assistance was most visibly demonstrated when he asked his brother, a skeptical Wall Street computer programmer, for a loan to help him with the books printed. Not only did his brother give him the money requested, he gave it as a gift. Clearly, he says, the infinite power was at work. How does one go about this inner listening? He says, the key is to get quiet, still the mind, and allow the inner wisdom to bubble from the depths. In the words of Ralph Waldo Emerson, let us be silent that we may hear the whispers of the gods. Mr. Block tells us that when the voice you follow is really that of your intuition, a number of clear signs will follow. One, a deep peace and tranquility will enfold you. You will experience abundant energy, vitality, and joy. You will be supported by invisible hands. And quoted from him again, when you listen to your inner voice and act on it, your experience will be accompanied by peace, clarity, joy, and assistance from the universe. What happens when you ignore this inner message and succumb to message from outside yourself? Clear signs will also be present. You will experience less energy, anxiety instead of peace, confusion instead of clarity, burden instead of joy, blocks instead of flow. End of quote. He advises that when this detour from peace and clarity occurs, we should use the universe's feedback to get us back on course. When we go within and listen for guidance, the universe will always lovingly direct us to the path of our highest good. To quote Joel Goldsmith, when we have rested, when we have become still, and when we have permitted the spirit to permeate mind and body, a something greater than ourselves goes before us and prepares the way for us. A something greater than ourselves goes before us and prepares the way for us. Diligence, my friends. Namaste.